Hey students, it's Miss Duke again today. I'm going to be reading to you Chapter 2, Children of the Dust Bowl, page 11. 2. Mother Road. The Okies drew strength from the wind that blew them out of the panhandle. Penniless, broken by hardship and poverty, they were determined to conquer adversity. Crowding around campfires on the open prairie amid the ruins of their farmhouses and fields, they started to talk about the distant place where, it was reported, there was food, work, sunshine, and clear skies. California, California, California. To the Okies, the word California was magical, describing a place where they could go to better their lives. It was said that thousands of workers were needed to harvest 100 different crops, peaches, pears, tomatoes, potatoes, beans, apples, oranges. The list seemed endless. It was said that no one ever went hungry in California because of lush orchards were everywhere and people just helped themselves to whatever fruits or vegetables they wanted. It was said that no one ever got sick out there, ever. And it was big news if anyone died in California before their 200th birthday. Above all, the Dust Bowlers believed that they would find work in California if they could get there. They believed this because growers in California sent thousands of handbills to Oklahoma and other Dust Bowl states, handbills that said things like, 300 workers needed for peaches, plenty of work, high wages, and 500 men for cotton, needed now. Start work right away. When the Okies read these advertisements nailed on trees and old telephone poles, there was but one thing to do. As one man in Pelham, Oklahoma put it, all you could hear was going to California, going to California. Nobody talking about nothing except going to California. Top of page 12. The advertisements for workers led to what was called the Dust Bowl Migration. It was the largest migration of people in U.S. history. Between 1935 and 1940, over 1 million people left their homes in Oklahoma, Texas, Arkansas, and Missouri and moved to California. Most of the migrants were white, but the exodus from southwestern states also included some black families. Among the migrants, 375,000 Okies cursed the wind, the dirt, and the drought one last time, then set out for California. It was a sight, it was. The Okie sold what few valuable possessions they still had, an old tractor, a plow, perhaps a cow that had survived. Then aunts and uncles, brothers and sisters, parents and grandparents pulled their money to buy an old jalopy or a beat-up flatbed truck. Soon the vehicles would be loaded down with tools, pots, pans, bulging suitcases, guitars, wash tubs, and mattresses. And always, straddling the 10-foot-high mountain of family possessions, there were children, often six or more, whose job it was to make sure the rope stayed tight and nothing was lost. For others, there was nothing to sell, nothing to pack. Many of these Okies rode the trail to California, sneaking aboard empty railroad boxcars heading west. Some, such as Roy Abbott of Colgate, hitchhiked to California. Moving day, Roy said, consisted of what's calling the dog and spitting on the fire. For those with their own vehicles, an old car with three mattresses lashed to its roof was called rich. A car with two mattresses was said to be mediocre. And if someone saw a car with just one mattress, they'd say, there goes a poor Okie. Top of 14. While preparing for the trip of nearly 2,000 miles, which might take them 3 weeks to 6 months, many Okie families sang the popular Jack Bryant song, Sunny Cow. You've all heard the story of old Sunny Cow, the place where it never rains. They say it don't know how. They say, come on, you Okies, work is easy found. Bring along your cotton sack, you can pick the whole year round. Top of 15. Then one by one, the overloaded trucks sputtered onto Route 66, which the Okies called Mother Road. Today, most of Route 66 is closed or in a state of disrepair. But the Okies who rode Mother Road to California will never forget the blast furnace heat, the winding mountain roads, the bridgeless rocky paths, and the washed out mud banks, the hunger and the uncertainty that threatened them every mile of the way. When Okies recall the Dust Bowl migration, they remember every town. First, Shamrock and Amarillo in northern Texas, and then Tamuckria and Alberta in New Mexico, and on to Holbrook, Flagstaff, and in Kingsman, Arizona, and the Needles and Bairstow as they entered California. They remember every hardship and every happy moment. Top of page 116. Edgar and Myrtle Masters packed their children in the old Studebaker in Hollis, Oklahoma, and headed down Mother Road in 1938. They had four flat tires in the first 50 miles. Rosaline Long was 9 years old when her family of five and an old cranky young couple with a louder toddler left Stewart, Oklahoma. Rosalind remembered that the family got caught in a flood in Gallup, New Mexico, and was forced to hide out for a week in a large tin building with 12 other families until flood water subsided. The Okies worked along the way. They might pick cotton in Tweedy, Texas to earn enough money to get to Wickiup, Arizona, in time for the lettuce and carrot harvest. If their truck broke down or they ran out of gas, which happened often, some of the men would hitchhike to the nearest town and get odd jobs and maybe earn 50 cents, enough money for repairs or for gas the next day. At the end of the day, the families would camp by the side of the road and wash clothes. If there was a stream or ditch nearby, they ate sugar-cured bacon brought from Oklahoma stuffed in lard cans. And if they were lucky, they had a meal of boiled potatoes and carrots. They cooked outside, slept outside, went to the bathroom in the woods, bathed when they could, and did whatever it took to get to the next day. Lloyd Stursey's family, eight boys and four, top of page 18, girls, slept outside next to Mother Road. With all of our blankets and sleeping bags, Lloyd said, we looked like a checkerboard all laid out. Comparing the trip to life in Prague, Oklahoma, Lloyd said, we didn't have no running water or electricity, but we didn't have that in Oklahoma either. Love Stoops of Chautauqua remembered when his family ran out of food and all that was left was coffee. The coffee was shared by the adults, and then the children took spoons and ate the coffee grounds. Once the Okies family reached Kingman in western Arizona, they faced a new challenge. From Kingman, Route 66 wound upward in the cactus and scattered rock of Black Mountains. As this stretch of Mother Road climbed higher and higher, the steep grade, the hairpin turns, and the absence of guardrails tested every vehicle and the determination of each family. Women and children often walked to the summit rather than face the perilous climb in an unreliable car. They carried wash tubs and bundles of clothing to ease the strain on the family's jalopy. Horace Ray Conley, who had described the sky above the panhandle as blood red, was 15 when his father's 1930 ton and a half truck approached the foothills of the Black Mountain. It was loaded with two beds, a stove, a dining table, and a couch. When the father refused to take the wheel, Horace shifted the old truck into low gear and started up the grade alone. He climbed about a mile before the truck's clutch failed. Two truckers from Maine fed cantaloupes to the Conley family and gave them a ride back to one of the many gas stations in Kingsman. Once through the Black Mountain, the Okies had to prepare for their most severe test, crossing 143 miles of Mojave Desert, page 20, between Needles and Barstow, California. Here, there were towns and few gas stations. Here, fan belts snapped, radiation cranked, and the floorboards turned frying pan hot in the daytime temperatures that frequently exceeded 120 degrees. The family prepared for this part of the trip as if they were going into battle, checking tires and brakes, securing food, gas, and water. Most made the journey at night and always at a slow speed, keeping a steady eye on the temperature gauge. I used to tell them, a local businessman said of the Okies, it isn't surprising that people die along Route 66. The miracle is that any of you make it through at all. To help survive the hardest times, the Okies wrote songs as they enjoyed the caravan of rundown jalopies on Mother Road. They would sing, if the day looks kinder gloomy and the chances kinder slim, if the situation's puzzling and the prospects awful grim, and perplexities keep pressing till all hope is nearly gone, just bristle up and grit your teeth and keep on going on. Another song, going down the road feeling bad, went like this. I'm going down the road feeling bad. I'm going down the road feeling bad. I'm going down the road feeling bad. Lord, Lord, I ain't gonna be treated this away. Always, they kept up hope, the hope that the truck would not overheat again, hope that the tires would last one more day, hope that there would be enough food and water for tomorrow, and hope there would eventually light in California, and above all, hope that they would find a job when they got there. Thank you, guys. I'll see you Tuesday.